It is very, very important. So now I'll take one complete lecture to demonstrate with example with the maximum likelihood estimation. But for the time being, so unbiased estimation that all of you, if you have statistics course, so you have already come across this term. What is called this simple random sampling and this simple random sampling with replacement. Okay, so now estimation means that if average, you need to take the average of the value. So if your population average is equal to the sample average, then you will say this is an unbiased estimation. Okay, so that's what it is written. If average of the value is equal to the original value, is called the unbiased. And this sample random sampling without replacement. So we have taken some examples. Suppose you have some data points are taking from some distribution. Now the data points are 1, 2, 3, 4. Now the population average is that this is 2.5. Now you need to take two points at a time, and you need to take the average. Now you first take 1, 2, then 1, 3, 1, 4, and then you take the average. Then you have to take 2, 3, 2, 4, 3, 4. Then you need to take the average. Then you need to take the overall average. Now as you can look at this average, is total average is equal to the for each samples that is a population average. So this is called the unbiased. Okay, and this simple random sampling with replacement, that you need to consider for the all different possible combinations. So this is called the pairs, and this kind of estimation, that's it is known as, this is IID. That is a oftenly you'll come across the term, the independent and identically distributed random variable. Okay, so now this, it supports these things. Okay, so independent means that the output of the one trial will not affect the output of the other trial. Suppose if you have taken if you have an unbiased coin, now you are just flipping the coin 10 times. Now in the 5 times you are going to get head, and the 5 times you are going to get the tail. Now the output of the first trial does not necessarily will have any impact, this output of getting head, that does not necessarily will have any impact that this output of getting tail. So that's why these two events are called the independent. Now identically distributed means that throughout the experiment you are not changing the distribution. So that's why it is called the IID. Okay, and this density function. So is the slide is changing, na?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, in the first class, that you also, whenever I asked you that what is the density function or probability density function, also you have given me some clue, but more specifically, a probability density functions can be a density function if it satisfies two property. So one of the property is that fx is greater than is equal to zero. Okay, for all x is an element in R. R means in the real space. So x is a point. So now if you take any functions, and if the functions, after evaluating, if the function is greater than is equal to zero for all x belongs to R, then it is a probability density function, along with that in integration of minus infinity to infinity fx dx is equal to 1. I mean the area under the curve is equal to 1. Now these triangular distributions, that is, as you can check, that is fx is greater than is equal to 0. Okay, and also this, if you compute this area under the curve, so you can also find this 1. So now if any type of, so if you choose any function, and if it is called as a probability density function, then it must be satisfies this two property. Because why I am explaining this thing, because after that I'll be showing the Bayes decisions rule. So it is one of the best classifier which is used in many applications. So now it satisfies these two properties. One is called the fx greater than is equal to zero, and minus infinity fx dx is equal to one. Next is you can also check for the there's a lot of many types of distributions are available, so you'll have to check it. There's a exponential distributions. Okay, so I'm not going to get into details all these things. I'm just touch upon things. What are the distribution is? Okay, and this then you will have this normal distribution. So all of you know about this normal or Gaussian distribution. So now these normal distributions can be written, that is an x, then n. So capital N, it denotes the normal, then mu comma sigma, it has got two parameters, you know, mean and variance. Then x follows this mean and this variance. Now the its probability density function is given, fx is equal to 1 by root over 2 pi into 1 by sigma, or you can simply have 1 by sigma root over 2 pi in you can also take exponential of minus half x minus mu by sigma whole square. Okay. Now as you can see, in many places that you oftenly see that you can look at any research materials or any research paper, the people are oftenly use the normal distribution. Why? Means why people are using the normal distribution or the Gaussian distribution? So do you have any idea? What are the advantage that this that Gaussian distribution has got? So that always you'd like to use the normal distribution or Gaussian distribution. Any kind of things that you which comes in your mind? Anyone?
Sir, it's much closer to the real life situations.
More mathematically? It is a parametric distribution, isn't it? It is a parametric distribution. You have got two parameters, mu and sigma, and you can easily compute it. Isn't it? And one of the best property of normal distribution is that it follows the central limit theorem. Have you heard the name central limit theorem? In statistics, so there is a concept is called central limit theorem. So any distributions which follows a non-normal distributions that can be approximated to a normal distribution, that you can show, because using the central limit theorem. So now if you have any arbitrary distributions which follows by your data points, now if you have just estimated compute it by its parameters, and if you would just try to approximate it using its to its normal distributions. Okay, so any type of distribution, if you have beta distribution, gamma distributions, then you have theta distributions, all other distributions are there. Okay, then if in the central limit theory, if this the sigma, mu and sigma, that if you can estimate in such a way so that it follows the normal distribution, so that it follows this central limit theorem. So one of the best property of the normal distribution is called it follows the central limit theorem. And another advantage is that it's a mathematically tractability. So mathematical tractability, it means that it is a parametric, you can easily estimate mu and sigma square. So that is why in many real life applications that people are trying to use this normal distribution. Although if it is not going to follow a normal distribution, but it is not necessarily true that all the data points will follow a normal distribution in real life. In ideal case, it's fine, it follows a normal distribution. But in real life problems, you cannot get all of the ideal case. You will have the non-ideal case. So in the non-ideal case, if it is does not follow a normal distribution, you'll have to approximate it. You'll have to approximate the distribution in such a manner, okay, so that it will follow the normal distribution. So there is a different techniques for approximation. One of the techniques that I can tell you that you can take, this is called the box quox transformations. B-O-X, box, C-O-X, quox. Box quox transformation. You need to transform the data points in such a way that it is likely to follow a normal distribution. Because if you see that your data points are follows normal distribution, then you can easily use this classic multivariate Gaussian. Okay, those classifier which follows this probabilistic based classifier that you can apply. Okay, so that is why I just tell you that firstly you need to check the data distribution. So before applying any probabilistic based classifier that you have, you need to first check the distribution of the data. If your data is follows a Gaussian distributions or any other distribution, then you can choose, yes, I should follow a density function, but this density function should clearly follow this distribution, either normal or this triangular or the beta distribution or F distribution, T distribution, so on. Okay, so you can see, so this is a very good book. You can find this is C.R. Rao, Linear Statistical Inference and Application. You can just look at it, its application. Next is called the bivariate. So bivariate normal distribution, that all the details are there using this Gun Gupta Das Gupta book. There is a Fundamental of Statistics, Volume 1, Volume 2. There's a very good book. Then in the bivariate, you have mean. Mean means that is the expected value. Okay, so the EX can be written by minus infinity to plus infinity X fx dx. It is a continuous domain. But in a discrete domain, it is I is equal to 1 to infinity. So we have already seen this in the discrete domain, that we have taken an example, the salary of this each workers, okay, in any state, then what is the average salary of this thing, that we have already seen, that EX is equal to I is equal to 1 to infinity XI PI. That is called the probability mass function. Okay, so now this thing, this is a bivariate normal distribution, 1 by sigma root of sigma root 2 pi into integration x exp minus half x minus mu square into sigma into dx. You need to integrate it. Now here we are taking mu is equal to x fx dx and sigma square is equal to x minus mu square into fx dx. You just put it in this equation, then what you're going to get, that you're trying to establish the expected value of mu and expected value of variance. If your expected value of mu, that is a ex, is equal to mu, and the expected value of variance, that's e of x minus ex, is equal to sigma square, then your estimation is correct, or that you have already computed. Here you can say x minus mu is equal to y, that you can choose it. Now you have to do the differentiation with respect to dy and dx. So dy is equal to dx sigma. Okay, if you just do it, then x is equal to sigma y plus u. Okay, now you just put it. There is a derivation is there in this book also. Here, so this proof is there in this book, you can find. And it is an odd function. As you know, you cannot have the integration of the odd function because g of y is equal to minus gy. So it is zero. Then you can simply have the x is equal to mu. Now, in the variance, that e of x minus, you just put the mu, because x minus mu square, that is e of x square, then you will have x minus mu square into fx ds, that is sigma square. So it is not required, because all those who are the statisticians, the statistical students, so they can do all these things, because you'll have to know just what is the bivariate normal distribution. So I just wanted to tell you this thing. Next is very important, very, very important in your case, that you are going to apply it in Tomorrow's Machine Learning Laboratory. That is called practical implementation of Bayes decision rule using multivariate Gaussian. Okay, now first you need to know what is this multivariate distribution. Okay, so just a minute. Yes. Now, what is multivariate distribution? Now, in the multivariate distribution, as you are having this more than one variables, okay, then what you are going to do, that x is a random variables. It has got n dimensional feature vector, and you have n is a normal distribution. Then mu is a vector. It is not a single point. Mu is a vector. It is a column vector. So that's why mu underline. Then sigma. This sigma is called the covariance matrix. Okay. As we have already seen the concept of the covariance matrix. Okay. So this sigma, that it is called this covariance matrix, and its dimension is n cross n. Okay. Because as we have already seen that this covariance matrix is a positive definite matrix, and it is a non-singular matrix. Okay. Because if it is a singular matrix, then this determinant is zero, then obviously it should be a non-singular matrix, and it is a symmetric matrix that we have already seen. So now what is the formula for multivariate Gaussian? Now the formula is fx. Fx is the density function. Now this density function follows whose distribution? Multivariate Gaussian or multivariate normal distribution. And its formula is follows, is as follows. 1 by root over 2 pi to the power m. M means there is a dimension of the feature vector. Okay. M dimensional feature vector. You have m columns. Okay. Suppose height is a feature. Weight is a feature. It is a two dimension. Now, if you have the eye color, you can take another dimension. Okay. Length of the nose, another dimension. So that's why you have total m dimension. M columns. So that's why it is root over 2 pi to the power m. Determinant of sigma to the power half. Determinant of sigma to the power half. Exponential of minus half. X is a vector. It is a column vector. Minus mu. Mu is also a vector, mean vector. X is a column vector. Mu is a mean vector. X minus mu to the power transpose. A prime, or you can say this is a transpose. Then this is a sigma to the power sigma inverse, okay, and x minus mu. Now what is this meaning exactly? Now I am assuming that you know the little bit of concept of the linear algebra. Now in the linear algebra that we have seen, that this determinant of sigma cannot be always positive. Determinant of sigma cannot be always positive. It may be zero, it may be negative. Okay. Now, if it is negative, then you will see that there is a half is there, square root of. Okay. If determinant of sigma is negative, then you have the square root of negative. Then it is a real number. Okay. So if it is a real number, then the fx will, condition for the density function is violating, because the condition for the density function, it is a real, okay. Square root of the mean, it is a complex number, okay. If the determinant of sigma is negative, then if you evaluate it, negative to the power half, then it is a complex number. Which cannot allow you, means which is violating the definition of the density function. So that the determinant of sigma cannot be negative. So it may be zero or positive. But if it is zero, then whole thing is not defined. If it is zero, then 1 by 0, then it is not defined. So now it is necessarily the determinant of sigma, it is necessarily positive. Are you understanding me? Then the determinant of sigma will necessarily be a positive. Okay. Next, in the exponential of minus of now 1 by root over 2 pi to the power 1 by root over 2 pi to the power m, it is a constant, so it is fine. Okay, now these things I have to evaluate it. Minus half x minus mu transpose. So now x is a column vector. It is 1 minus n cross 1. Mu is a mean vector. It is also n cross 1. Now if you just subtract it, you will also have the n cross 1. Now n cross 1, if you just the transpose, you will have 1 cross n. So it is 1 cross n. Now sigma to the power inverse. So now as if it is a singular matrix, so if you have singular matrix, I mean this sigma is a positive definite matrix, and also it is a non-singular. Okay, now if it is singular matrix, you cannot have the inverse. So obviously it should be a non-singular, and this is the size of the matrix is n cross n, because it is a square matrix. Now you have 1 cross n, n cross n, and next is x minus mu. X is a column vector, mu is a mean vector. Then it is also 1 cross n cross 1. Now 1 cross n into n cross n, you will have this 1 cross n, and x minus mu is n cross 1. So 1 cross n into n cross 1 is a scalar. Are you understanding me? So the dimension is very, very important. Now exponential to the power anything. Now exponential to the power anything is greater than 0. Exponential to the power anything is greater than 0. So now these things is satisfying. I mean, so this fx is necessarily be a probability density function. Okay, are you understanding this intermediate portion? X minus mu transpose sigma inverse x minus mu means from where? So if you just evaluate it, because in lab you have to evaluate it, and the dimension is very important. So if the dimension is mismatching, you are not going to get the correct answer. Okay, so now you will have to have this scalar one. Now exponential to the power anything will have the positive. So am I clear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. So now this is very, very important formula. So you have to understand the formula, and also when I am saying that it is an fx is a density function, then I have to prove it. So whether it's satisfying this property or not. So that you have to compute it for this thing, because for both the classes, now if you are going to solve two class classification problem. Now if you are going to solve a binary class classification problem or two class classifications problem, for the first class, you need to compute this class conditional probability density function. When I am using the class conditional, means for each class that you have to compute the density function. So now density function for normal distribution for the class 1, again the density function for normal distribution for class 2. Okay, then you have to check it, that I'll come afterwards. So now, so this is a very, very important formula, that is called this density function for Gaussian distribution, or you can say this is a multivariate Gaussian density function. So now here x sigma must should be strictly positive definite. Now if it is strictly positive definite, then eigenvalues is greater than is equal to 0. Okay, here some other MLE portion is there, then I'll just come afterwards, not now. It is just a classification thing, how to recognize your vowel in speech. So I'll come all these things in afterwards, so not now. I'll be sharing this another PPT. So these are these different applications that people are looking for the machine learning. Then you have the character recognition, computer added diagnosis, speech recognition, face recognition, biometric image data mining, biometrics, lot of applications. Now the task is that you have to assign known object, unknown objects, okay, which is not being trained. Unknown object, that is called the pattern, into correct class. So this is known as classification. Unknown object, that is called the pattern, into the correct class, which is known as classification. And now the terms is called the features. So now throughout the few lectures, so you are well acquainted with the features and feature vector. Now what are the features? So now as you can see, there is a three important space. One is called the measurement space, feature space and decision space. So now what are the things? In the features, so they are the measurable quantities you can obtain from the patterns. You need to extract some meaningful information from the pattern, or which will be used as a distinguishing element to separate between two classes. Okay, you'll have to extract some intrinsic information or significant information from the pattern, which will be used to distinguish between two classes or to separate between two classes. And these are the measurable quantities obtained from the pattern, and the classification task is based on their respective values. Now the feature vectors you have, as you can see, if you write simply x, then underline, it has got n components, or you can simply have the l component. So where you can write x1, x2 till xl means l dimensions. Okay, and it contributes as a feature vector. As you can see, x underline, x1 comma x2 xl transpose. Okay, as you, because to save this space, space means not this computational space, to set this space in this PPT, simply we can write in a column way, row vector, x1 comma xl, then transpose. In this, in RL means L dimensional Euclidean space or L dimensional real space. So these feature vectors are treated as a random vectors. Okay, and suppose an example that you have these two images that you'd like to have. There's a malignant, cancerous region, or it is a non-cancerous region that you would like to just classify it to region. Now, if you take the two features, there's a sigma, mu and sigma. It is a feature space, and in the feature space, you have taken some sample points from one class, suppose class A, and which is denoted by plus, and another samples that you have taken from the class B, which is denoted by the circle. Now any unknown pattern comes, which is stars, then you need to classify it. So this is our decision boundary, or you can say decision space, as we can say in a straight line. Suppose y is equal to mx plus c, you can have simply boundary, okay, with some gradient and some intercept point, which is touches in the y-axis. Okay, and the points that is which is nearer to the decision boundary, then it classified it one of the classes. As you can see, this star is very closest to all the data points in the class V. Then obviously this point will be classified in class B based on the distance. So you can compute the minimum distance classifier techniques. Okay, and this boundary is a linear boundary. So there is a very important concept in machine learning is called the linear classifier and non-linear classifier. The linear classifier means if the two data sets are linearly separable, then this boundary is called the linear boundary. And if the data sets are non-linearly separable, this is called the non-linear decision boundary, or you may have sometimes piecewise linear boundary. Either it is a linear boundary or it is a non-linear boundary. Okay, it is just for your sake of illustration that is being given, that you can understand what is this classic means, what is the decision space, what is the decision boundary. So this line, it is called as a decision boundary, which separates between two classes based on the two features. One is sigma, another is mu, that you can easily compute it. Next is a classifier consists of a set of functions. Okay, actually classifier is a nothing but a mathematical function. Okay, whose values computed at x. Okay, and you have to determine the class to which the corresponding pattern belongs. So based on the criterion functions, or this, you have to determine which class the pattern belongs to. Based on this, the features that you have extracted from these different classes, then you'll have to do it. Now these are the classification systems that is we are going to use. Firstly, you need to suppose you are going to develop one classification system. Then what steps needs to be followed? Firstly, sensor, from the sensors that you can extract the pattern, from the sensor you can acquire. So you'll have to acquire some pattern from the sensors. Then you'll have to do the feature generations Okay, from here you can take any type of sensor. You can take these light sensors, you can take this camera, you can take the wearable sensors, you can say the body worn sensors, different type of sensors which are available. Okay, from these sensors that you can generate the features. From the features you have to extract this feature selection, and then you have to classify, you have to design the classifier. Then you will have to do this system evaluation. That is very, very important. So now after developing a classifier, you need to evaluate the performance of the classifier. So that is very important, because how much robust your classifier that you have developed, that you need to evaluate it. So now the performance evaluation of any classifier can be done in different ways. Accuracy, you can check with the accuracy. So accuracy is not only a single metric. So it is better if you have to do the performance evaluation with some statistical metric like this. You can have the precisions, you can compute this recall, you have to compute this F1 measure. So these are the very, very standard matrices. That it is not this metric, METRICS. So these standard metrics are used to evaluate the performance of the classifier. All is called the precision, recall. What are those things? I'll be explaining to you, all of you. I'll be explaining all the terms. Okay, well, I'll be taking a one class for the error, classification error, or this error probability. Then all the things will come up. So now if you just compute the confusional matrix, okay, let's do it. Hello, can you hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Actually, some problem was there. Anyway, firstly, you will have to design a confusion matrix. So, have you heard this name, confusion matrix? Anyone? If you just develop a confusion matrix for any classifier, actually, from the confusion matrix, so you can easily compute the precision, recall, and F1 measure. And also you need to do some plotting. What is called the ROC curve, receiver operating characteristics curve. So ROC curve is very much important, where you will have the false positive rate and the you can say the false acceptance rate and the false rejection rate, FAR and FRR. So there is a trade-off between FAR and the FRR. So then these are the all sort of things. So which the last thing, system evaluation. Though the system evaluations can be done through different statistical matrices, precision, recall, F1 measure, or the ROC curve, and also you can develop the confusion matrix. From the confusion matrix itself, you can compute all these things. Next is supervised and unsupervised pattern recognition that we have already discussed. Supervised means pattern whose class is known a priori, are used for training, and unsupervised means the number of classes is in general unknown and no training patterns are available. So it is called the unsupervised. We'll be using some different clustering methods. That is very important things. Now classifier based on the Bayes decision rule. So I'm going to tell you very important things. What is the Bayes decision theory? Okay, so now you have the statistical nature of feature vector like this x1, x2, xl, that is a L dimensional feature vector that you are having, and you have to assign the pattern represented by feature vector x to the most probable of the available classes. So what are the classes? Sometimes some book you can find classes can be written by c1, c2, cm. So if it is cm, means you have m classes. That is called the multi-class. One is these two type of class. One is the binary class classification. Another is the multi-class classification. If it is written C1, C2, CM, means they are going to do the multi-class classification. So means sometimes in place of C, this Dudahart book, or this theoretics book, it follows W1, W2, and WM. So because these slides that I am sharing with you, this is called the theoretics book. Okay, so W1, W2, and WM. So now that is that X is belongs to, so X is a pattern, okay, is belong to WI. Okay, if X is belong to WI, which means that this P of WI that is given XI. So now you need to do compute this posterior probability. So this probability is called the posterior probability. What is the probability that this training pattern is belongs to one of the classes? Because whenever it is trained, then you'll have to test with the unknown patterns. So now the unknown pattern comes in X, okay, and you'll have to check that whether X belongs to either, suppose if you are going to solve this two class classification, and you have two classes, first we'll have to use this two class, there alone we'll see the multi-class. Okay, now if you have the two class, then you have W1 and W2. Now what you have to do, X is belong to this W1 and this W2, I mean you have the two different patterns for these two classes, then you have to compute P of W1 is P of W1X and P of W2X. So it is that you have to compute. So it is called the probability, posterior probability. And which one is maximum? Then you can classify this pattern in one of these classes. Now how to compute a posterior probabilities? So that is the thing. So all of you know the Bayes rule. Okay, I'm assuming that you know the what is the Bayes theory. Bayes theory pata hai sabko? What is Bayes theory? Huh? What is the formula of Bayes theory? Anyone?
Sir, given probability for some condition upon total probability.
Probability of hypothesis given evidence is equal to probability of evidence given hypothesis into probability of hypothesis divided by probability of evidence, where this probability of evidence is the total probability. Yehi to hai na?
Yes, sir.
So probability of hypothesis given evidence is equal to, so this is probability of given hypothesis, probability of hypothesis given evidence, this is called the posterior probability, is equal to, then this you have some, you have some components in this numerator, that is probability of hypothesis, evidence given hypothesis, that is called the likelihood function, then probability of hypothesis, this is called the prior probability, divided by total probabilities. Now total probability is a probability is hypothesis, that is summation of I is equal to 1 to n, okay, or you can have the I is equal to 1 to c or I n, then this probability of evidence given hypothesis into probability of hypothesis. So here we'll be using the same concept. You have to compute this a posteriori probabilities or posterior probabilities, assuming that you have known the prior probabilities, that is capital, as I already told you, that prior probability will be denoted by capital P, and this likelihood function, or that is called the density function, or there is a density function for Gaussian distribution, that if you say, or any other distribution, that is called the, it is small p. Small p is a probability density function. So there's a P of X given WI. Okay, where X is a vector, it has got the L components, X1, X2, X3, XL, and WI. So it is a generalized way of writing. If you have the two class, then your likelihood functions will be PX W1, PX W2. If you are M class, you have PX W1, W2, W3 till WM. Now this is also known as the likelihood of X with respect to WI. So this function small p X WI is called the likelihood function. Likelihood function. Okay. And it is known to you. This likelihood functions will be known to you. If it is not known to you, you have to estimate it. Suppose in some cases, whenever you are going to solve some real life problem, the density function will not be given to you. If it is not going to give to you, then you have to estimate it. So then we'll have to use the different estimation technique. One of the technique is called the maximum likelihood estimation. Then if it is a parametric thing, then if it is a non-parametric model, if there is a non-parametric distributions are there, then we'll have to use the Poisson window. So I'll be also discussing the very important concept is called the Poisson window, P-A-R-Z-E-N, Poisson window. This is called the non-parametric distribution. Okay, non-parametric way of doing this thing. Okay, or you can say the Poisson density estimation. Poisson density estimation, like the maximum likelihood estimation for the like parametric way, but then is a non-parametric way. You have the Poisson density estimation, or you have this another estimation is called the nearest neighbor estimation rule. Nearest neighbor estimation rule. Okay, from the nearest neighbor estimation rule, I'll be establishing the formula is called the KNN. K nearest neighbor. Okay, I think all of you have heard this name, KNN rule. K nearest neighbor. So from the nearest neighbor estimation rule, we'll be establishing this KNN. So these things will be given to you, as I already told you. So whenever you are going to apply the Bayes decision rule, two things will be given to you. One is called the prior probability, and another is called the class conditional probability density function. Suppose if the prior probability is not given to you, then how do you compute it? How do you compute this prior probability? Anyone? If the prior probability is not given to you, then how do you compute prior probability? Can anyone just tell me? The data so points So the prior probability means it is just this. What are the percentage of the data points which are coming from the class 1, and what are the percentage of the data points which are coming from the class 2? If it is not at all given to you, you can easily compute it by N1. Suppose you have two class, W1 and W2, and the total number of data points is given to you, that is capital N. Now, the prior probability of only first class will be capital N1 by capital N, and prior probability of the second class will be capital N2 by capital N. If I'm telling the 60% of the entire populations are coming from the class 1 and this rest of the things are coming from the class 2, you can easily compute N1 by capital N and N2 by capital N, because the summation of I is equal to 1 to C or I is equal to 1 to M, capital PI is equal to kya hoga? Summation of I is equal to 1 to C or 1 to M, capital PI is equal to
1.
Very good. Because you cannot have this probability greater than 1. Okay, then there's a rule. There's a summation of I is equal to 1 to C. C means class, or M means class, capital P is equal to 1. Now, if it is written, the classes are equiprobable class. If it is written, the classes are equiprobable class, then what will be the prior probability for both the classes?
1 by 2.
Very good. If you have two class, and if it is saying that this prior probability for both the classes are same, then you have this prior probability plus first one, that is capital P1 is equal to half, and capital P2, that is prior probability for the second class, is half. This is called the equiprobable classes. Okay, so the term is called the equiprobable. Now here the Bayes rule for M is equal to 2, M means class, that is, these are the formula that we used to have. Px into PWIx, I mean, you can simply write capital PI, small PI, I mean capital PIx, small PIx is equal to there is a capital Pj x small Pj x. Oh yeah, you can simply write Px Pwy x is equal to Px Pwy. Pw. You can write it. That is a Pwy x is equal to Px Wy into Pw by Px, where Px I is equal to. So this denominator term is called. This is a total probability, that is I is equal to 1 to 2, as you are consider the two class. That is a Px Wy into Pi, because this term is same for both the classes. This denominator term is same for the both the classes, so that you can just neglect it. Okay, you can just neglect it. So you can simply have. So that's why in many books you can find that whenever you're going to check it, that Px Wy into Pwy, if it is greater than, that is Px Wj into Pwj. Okay. So actually it is in nothing but a posterior probability Pwy into x. Now if you use the equiprobable class, then again Pwy will be cancelled out, because half will be cancelled out into both the sides. Okay. For the Bayes rule, now you need to take a decision. That the Bayes classification rule, that given x, you have to classify it according to the rule. Now for the training class, you have computed this posterior probability, and for this prior probability, for the both the classes. Now the unknown pattern comes to you, that is x. Now you need to compute. You need to compute it, this posterior probability. Now if this condition, if Pw1x, where this x is a test class, is greater than Pw2x, then you would say x is belong to W1. Or if Pw2x is greater than Pw1x, it means that x is belong to W2. So that, as you can see here, it was written the maximum of Pwy into x. Okay, which one is larger, then it has to be classified these classes. Equivalently, you have to classify according to the rule. Now I am assuming that this Pw1x, it is a posterior probability. Now it is simply nothing but a Px density function, or you can have the likelihood function with respect to x. Pxw1 into Pw1, it is greater than, or you can have the less than. It's up to you how you are going to, check it. Okay, if you have to check it, Pxw1 Pw1, if it is greater than Pxw2 Pw2, then you will have this decision boundary, or you can have the decision rule. Now whenever someone will ask you what is the Bayes decision rule, you should tell this small Pxw1 capital Pw1, if it is greater than small Pxw2 capital Pw2. And for the equiprobable class, then this Pw1 capital Pw1 and the capital Pw2 will be cancelled out in both the side. You will have to simply have only you have to check the likelihood function. Pxw1 is greater than Pxw2. Okay, now these are the density function plot. That is very, very interesting things. In the x-axis, you will have the data points. In the y-axis, you are going to compute the density function, that is Xw1. Now this Pxw1, that is a density function for Gaussian distributions or any other distribution that you can compute. Now it is just a pictorial representation, we are going to assume it is a Gaussian distribution. Now in the red color, it is a Pxw1, that is a density function for class 1, and this is a black one, it is a density function for class 2. As you can see, so there is an overlapping area between these two things. Okay, so there is an overlapping area between these two things. Okay, now in the intersection area, so we are just making a threshold. This threshold is just denoting as a x naught. Okay, And by choosing the threshold, we are going to decide that we have two region. One is called R1, another is called the R2. Now you can see that the points originating from class 2, which is marked as in the shaded area in the black line, that you can say the points which is actually originating for W2, but it is classified in W1. So there is an error. Yes or no? The points which is actually originating from W2, but it is classified in R1 region. Means R1 means W1 region. So it is an error. Similarly, the points actually originating from W1, but it is classified in W2. So it is an error. So these are the errors. Because any classification technique or any classifier that you are going to design, you need to incur some error. You need to incur some error. I mean, you need to have some penalty. Okay. So that's why the term is called the misclassification. What is the error? Means what is the misclassification error probability that you need to compute? In the last class, in the last assignment, if you just followed, so there's a term was called the misclassification error probability. So what is the misclassification error probability? These are the misclassification error. I mean, the points which is actually from class 2, but it is classified in class 1. But by seeing the threshold, so X0 is a threshold. Now you can shift the threshold to some extent. You can shift the threshold X0 to in the left direction or in the right direction. It's up to you that how many points you are going to sacrifice. That the points actually belong to class 1, but I need to tell it is to be classified in class 2, that you just change the threshold. Similarly, the points which are actually from class 2, but I should also classify, I mean this classifier, it should also classify in class 2. You just change the threshold. I mean, you need to compromise. You need to compromise that which points that you need to consider it for classifications, okay? And which points you are not supposed to consider it for the classification. So that is a very vital thing. There is a trade-off. Here the error things is coming. When I was discussing, this is a false positive rate and a false acceptance regions and the false rejection region. So from these things, it will be common. Are you understanding this graph or not? Bolo.
Yes, sir.
Anyone? Do you have any doubt in the graph? Now, at any place, if your decision rule is something like that, PXW1 is equal to, I mean, the density function for the first class and the density function for the second class is same. Then the points that you are going to test it, that in at which class it will be classified? If the points are on the line, then in which class it will be classified?
Sir, we will randomly select any class.
Very good. You have to randomly select in any one of the classes because it will not much affect in your result. If any points, that is lie on the line, I mean decision boundary that we have chosen, I mean using the threshold, so it will be in any one of the classes. So now here R1 is W1 and R2 is W2. So equivalent in words that you have to divide this space in two region. If X is an element of R1, it means X in W1. If X is element of R2, then X is in W2. Now there is a probability of error. There is a total shaded area. As you can see that we have seen already total shaded area. It is called the probability of error. Now you need to compute it. So now the probability of this probability of error will be minus infinity to x naught. Okay, so x naught is your threshold. Now minus infinity to x naught p x w2 dx. It means that the points which is actually belong to class w2, but it is classified in w1. So now you need to compute this, how much error that you are incurring. Next is x naught to plus infinity. It means that the points which is actually from class 1, but it is classified in class 2. Then you need to compute this error. So this is the probability of error. P of x, x w2 dx into plus x w1 into x p w1. So are you understanding now? Now this total things, if you just compute this, I mean, that the area under the curve is 1. Okay. Now this base classifier is called optimal classifier with respect to minimizing the misclassification. Minimizing this classification error probability or misclassification error probability. So that is this important thing. So now you would say that, so base classifier is called this optimal classifier, and actually it is an optimal classifier with respect to minimizing the classification error probability. So this is the base decision rule that you need to follow in the lab itself. You have M classes or you can have the C classes. Class conditional density function will be given to you. P1x1, P2x, P1x, x is a vector. The P1 is a likelihood function, or you can have the density function for any distribution. P1x, P2x, PMx, where x is in Rn. So earlier it was in L dimensional real space. Now it is capital N dimensional real space. Prior probability is given to you. P1, capital P2, capital Pm. For each classes, prior probability will be given to you. Where prior probability in the range of 0 to infinity, 0 to 1 for all I is equal to 1 to M. So that the sum of I is equal to 1 to M, Pi is equal to 1. Now this is a decision rule. Put X. X is a test class. Put X is a test point. Put X in class I. Okay, if capital Pi, small Pi X is greater than is equal to capital Pj, small Pj X. For all J is not is equal to I. Okay, for all J is not is equal to I. So we have introduced the term is called greater than equal to, because equal to means if you have any points which belongs which belongs any one of the two classes, so you can just classify it either class I or either class J. Then it should be called as a base decision rule if it is minimizes the probability of misclassification. So that is the things that you need to consider. So this is a base decision rule, which is very important, which follows this multivariate Gaussian distribution. So the practical example that you will have to do in tomorrow's class, tomorrow lab, it is this apply Bayes' decision rule for all the satellite images. So you have these two images will be given to you. Okay, so you can just change the threshold. So I'll explain to you in the next class. So all the things. So now the practical assignment that you have to do, that you have to you have some satellite images of Kolkata that I'll give it to you. From the satellite images you have to these satellite images you will have the, there's a Hooghly River that you will get, that you have to classify this pixel intensity values in one of the two classes. One class is called the river class, another is called the non-river class. Okay, so these things that you will see, that I'll just explain. Yes, so this is a the data points will be given to you. The images will be given to you. You have to extract the data points. Then these are the Kolkata satellite images for R band, G band, RGBI image. I beat even then I win, then you have to show the output this way. That is the job. So here steps are written. Okay, so Joita will explain to you in next class, in the next lab. Okay, if you have any questions for the theory class, you can ask me now. So I'm going to stop it because it's already 9. Okay. Any questions you can ask me?
Sir, there is no so question for this. Just one thing related to the ML lab.
Yes.
I'm a PhD student. So for us, is there any plan you are going to assign us some lab, ML lab?
ML labs? I don't think so. You have some ML lab.
No, we don't have. But if somebody is interested to kind of participate.
Yes, you can join. I don't have any problem. But your things will not be evaluated.
I mean, yeah, that's fine, sir. Just for exposure to the practical things.
So,
because ultimately, we have to same in future research.
Yes, practical implementation is required for ML. Okay. Without practical implementation, anyway, so what I can do, those who are having lab, I think only software engineering student does not have lab. So few students have requested me to include them. So anyway, I can include them. So it is an online classes. So I don't have any problem. Okay. So if I teach 100 students or if I teach these 200 students, so it is same for me. Okay.
Because sir, without implementation, it's very difficult to actually understand the concept more better. So.
Yes. So what I can do? I can send you the assignment that we have made. To all of you after each lectures is over, then you can do the implementation that because we are in the lab also, we are having total 50 students. Okay, so 50 students, for each and every students we have to evaluate it. Okay, so I mean there will not be any official evaluation to all of you. Okay, because as you don't
that is fine, sir.
But these assignments that I can give it to you.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Sir, can we attend the lab also, sir? Can you please share the code also, sir?
Yes, you can attend the lab. There is a no problem. Okay. So I can share the code. Okay.
Yes, sir. As we have, sir, shifted our lab on the Wednesday afternoon to the morning up, just because can we attend the lab, ML lab, sir?
Okay. So I'll just generate the code today. Okay. And I'll just share all of you. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay. See you on next test. Okay.
Sir?
Yes.
Hello?
Please.
Yeah, sir, actually, I had a question. Like, sir, is multivariate distribution has anything to do with Bayes rule?
Yes, very good question.
So
actually,
so like which probability?
I'll just tell you. Actually, this multivariate distribution, you have seen fx, isn't it? Fx,
yes,
is equal to 1 by root over 2 pi to the power m determinant of sigma to the power half exp minus half x minus mu transpose sigma inverse x minus mu. Ye aapko bhi yaad ho jayega. Okay, this is not a big jump. So this fx is actually a small px given wi. Okay, this fx is actually a small px given wi. It is a likelihood function, the likelihood function or density functions. So these density functions will be given to you. You need to compute this density function through pixel intensity values. How to compute it? That I will explain to you. Okay, because ultimately whenever you are going to apply Bayes decision rule, then you have to implement the density functions. For the present moment, for the present assignment, it will be implemented the multivariate Gaussian. But in some other case also, you can simply use this this is a simple single variate Gaussian or univariate, not single variate, it's a univariate Gaussian you can apply, or you can apply the multivariate Gaussian. So whatever distribution that you are going to apply, this is for the density function. Density function for Gaussian distribution, the term can be written density function for triangular distribution, density function for beta distribution, all other distribution, because that this function follows some distribution, because whatever data points are given to you, you need to have some distribution, I mean, which fits the distribution, because so there is a concept is called the fitting a distribution. So whenever the term is called fitting a distribution, it means you are considering the density function, and these density functions can only be called when it satisfies these two properties. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. In last class, you told you will give us some idea like which distribution we should select. Sir, can you please give us some idea on that also?
Okay. So don't be panic. So I'll take a couple of lectures. Okay. So it is just starting of your level. So you'll get to know a lot of things about the statistics and how to fit a distribution. Okay. Which distribution you can choose. Okay. Wait. Okay. It come one by one.
Sir, actually, another class has also started.
Okay. You can join. Okay, so I'm just signing out.
Sir, just last question. Sir, in density function calculation, you told us there are two rules need to be satisfied. For each x, p of x should be greater than 1 and summation of px should be 1. Sir, you told about something about triangular inequalities there. Sir, how is that related to density?
That is different things. Triangular inequality for to check this whether this distance, whenever you are say the distance is called a metric. So that is the different classification technique. Okay, so it is a no connection with the base decision rule. Triangular inequality is different. Okay.
So you showed a graph where there were two triangular shapes. Sir, I couldn't match those things.
Triangular thing? Where I?
Yes, sir. In density functions, when you told two conditions to be satisfied, just below that you this graph.
No.
Sir, triangular distribution.
It is not it. Actually, triangular distribution means it is just you can take any. So I am using is there is a two multiple triangle is there, but you can take any one triangle. You can simply have the formula is the half base into height. Okay, it is not the concept of the triangular inequality. Triangular inequality is different than the triangular distribution. So triangular inequality is used whenever you are say that distance is called a metric. Distance means in the last class we have seen the lot of distances, isn't it? Equilateral distance, Manhattan distance, city block distance, Mohler-Novich distance. So whether this each distance can be called as a metric or not? Okay, does it satisfy this triangular inequality? Like the equilateral distance, it satisfies this triangular inequality. That is the things. But here this concept is different. It is called the triangular distributions. So now triangular distribution, if x is greater than 0, you take any values of x it must be satisfied. And this area under the curve of the triangular of the triangle is half base into height. Okay, so half base is 2, is height is 2. That you just plot it, half into base is 2, 0 to 2, and this there's a height is 1. So it is just 1. It is just a simple thing. So actually it should be only 1 because I have just wrongly plotted this red one. So it should be only this other one, because if you take this one itself from the 0 to 2 in the interval, I'll have the 1 in the here. So that's why it is done. So it is my drawing, so that I have drawn it. Okay, so it should be only 1. Okay, so means only 1 triangle.
Sir, what's the significance of a triangular distribution in probability density function calculation?
Actually, the concept is that so there is a lot of distributions are available. Okay, in statistics, so this distribution is a very important part. And when I would say that this triangular density function, so actually it is a triangular density function. And this triangular density function means density function which follows the triangular distribution. So that is called the triangular density function. Okay, so that is why this triangular distribution is coming. That's it. Suppose this multivariate Gaussian distribution means density function for multivariate normal or multivariate Gaussian, because you need to, for each density function supports some distribution. Each probability density function supports some distribution. So that is why this distribution is coming. So data distribution is very important part, fitting a distribution. So fitting a distribution is a very vast thing. Okay, so when for this, so that is why that I need to discuss it. Okay, we'll have the couple of discussions. Okay, some students having some classes. I think it's already
19. Also, sir, last thing, sir, can you share this PPT with us?
Me too.
I'll share. Okay, today I'll share. Okay, today I'll share. Thank you so much.